Let's pray. Father, you are the great I am. And may we see our life's purpose. As obeying you with everything that we have, with everything that we are, for your glory. For you are the great I am. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Obey has probably become one of the dirtiest words in all of America. Obey. You don't believe me? Turn to your wife right now and say, "Wife, you are supposed to love, honor, and obey me." Go ahead, do that. I dare you. And if we say that to our teenage children, "You're supposed to obey your parents," they may sue us for emancipation. No kidding. That's a real thing today. In the good old US of A, freedom is king. And obey is synonymous with slavery, with manipulation, with tyranny. There's a famous poet called Percy Shelley who said, "Power, like a desolating pestilence, pollutes whatever it touches. And obedience, the bane of all genius, virtue, freedom, truth, makes slaves of men and of the human frame a mechanized automaton." And that was written nearly 200 years ago. Kind of reminds me of a story. Bear with me here. The date was 1446 BC, 3,500 years ago. Pharaoh, as the son of Ra, the sun god himself, was the ultimate authority in all of Egypt. Egypt had been a pluralistic society for more than, well, a millennium. There were gods of the Nile, there was a sun god, the cattle god, the earth god of agriculture. Even Pharaoh himself was worshipped as the ultimate god. And as an advanced civilization, as an advanced culture, they were ranked second to none in that period of history. They were second to none in architecture, in mathematics, in literature, in irrigation, in engineering. If you don't believe me, look at the pyramids. They were at the top of the global food chain. They were accountable to none, beholding to none, and feared by all, the envy of the world. Does that sound at all familiar to you today? Might we say the same about America? But one day in 1446, out of the blue, this Hebrew shepherd, a guy by the name of Moses, shows up and he demands that Pharaoh release all of his Hebrew slaves, or the God of the Hebrews is going to strike Egypt with plagues. Now, this Moses is not completely unknown to Pharaoh's court. In fact, at one time, he had been a prince, an adopted prince in Egypt. But he had thrown all that away to come to the aid of his Hebrew people. And he had fled Egypt in disgrace. And now this same Moses, 40 years later, 80 years old, comes back and says, "Release the Hebrew people, or the God of the Hebrews will strike Egypt with a plague of turning water, the water of the Nile River, into blood, and all the fish will die." Well, what's the name of this God of the Hebrews? Well, his name is the I Am. The I Am. What kind of name is that for a God? The I Am says, release my people. And Pharaoh is thinking to himself, do you not know who I am? I'm Pharaoh, the son of Ra, the sun god. You can't tell me what to do. You don't know who I am. Get out of here. I don't listen to you. I don't obey your God. In fact, I'm going to double the work that your Hebrew people have to do. I'm going to make their job twice as hard. Making bricks and stuff like that. And so Moses, well, God, through Moses, turns the Nile River into blood, and it stinks to high heaven, and all the fish die. And so God's shown as a powerful God, but yet, nevertheless, Pharaoh's heart is hard, and so he just ignores that first plague. God says, well, okay, I got some more. Yeah. And so then all of a sudden he goes to Pharaoh again and says, if you don't let my people go, I'm going to send frogs all over Egypt. And they're going to get into your ovens. They're going to get into your beds. They're going to sleep with you at night. I don't know what you would call a lot of frogs, a plague. Thank you. A plague. Yeah. That's a good way to put it. A plague of frogs. Thank you. They're going to come out of the river, and they're just going to come into your homes. They're going to be all over the place. And sure enough, because Pharaoh's heart's hard, he won't obey the I Am. Egypt gets all these frogs. And after a while, they get tired of them. And so Pharaoh begs Moses to get them away. And so God takes them away. And after that, Pharaoh's heart's hard again. And again, you know what happens. Let me see. Water, blood, frog. Gnats. The next plague was gnats, like lice. And can you imagine that? You're trying to sleep and they're buzzing into your ear and going into your nose. And if you sleep with your mouth open, like sometimes my wife says I do, the gnats are going to fly down in your mouth and it would be really, really nasty. And so that plague comes and Pharaoh's heart's still hard. And after the plague of lice or gnats, then we have, let me see, water, blood, frogs, lice, flies. Oh, nasty, all over the place. In fact, the whole land was black because of all the flies. And still Pharaoh's heart was hard. Water to blood, frogs, lice, flies. Moraine. And then after that, there was the plague of the cattle. And they said, if you don't let my people go, your cattle are all going to die. And they just started dropping. And you know what happens when they drop? And after a few days in the desert heat, what happens to them? Oh, it's going to stink, isn't it? And that's exactly what happened. The animals died, and so all over Egypt there's dead animals, and the smell, the stench was just awful. But we weren't done, were we? We're not done yet. Because Pharaoh's heart was hard. You know, you're God, that I Am God. He doesn't know who I am, and I'm Ra, the sun god. And so with every plague, God, the great I Am, is smiting the gods of Egypt. And so after the plague of the cattle, see, water to blood, frogs, lice, flies, the marine, boils. Oh, now we're affecting the people themselves. And so there's boils, that festering boils that come out all over the Egyptians. Now you go over to the land of Goshen where the Israelites are. They don't have any of this. Their animals aren't dying. They're not getting any of the boils or anything like that. And so Pharaoh doesn't know why exactly, but the point is that everybody in Egypt and even the magicians of Pharaoh couldn't stand before Pharaoh because they're covered in boils. From head to toe, painful, itchy. I kind of think of them like chicken pox on steroids or something like that all over you, right? It was really painful. Itching all over the place. I'm sure nobody could sleep for all that time. And so anyway, he pleads with Moses, and Moses gets rid of those. And after that, he still won't let the people go. And then after the boils, it's getting real here, all right? It's going to get really real. Water to blood, frogs, lice, flies, marine, boils, hail. There was hail in Egypt like there has never been hail on the earth. In fact, they were warned and they were told, get your slaves in out of the fields. Get your, what land animals you have left out of the fields. There's going to be lightning and thunder and hail like you've never seen before. And even then, Pharaoh's heart was still hard. And after the plague of hail, if there was anything left in Egypt to eat, it was gone, because after that there was a plague of locusts. An army of locusts marched in from the east and just completely decimated the land of Egypt until there was not a single green thing left in all of Egypt. And by this time, the Egyptians are begging and pleading with Pharaoh to let the people go, because Egypt is decimated by all of these plagues. And Pharaoh's heart is still hard, and he's saying, you don't know who I am. Why would I listen to your I am? It wasn't done. The next to the last plague was the plague of darkness. And it was 3 days of darkness that could be felt. It was that kind of darkness. I picture it kind of like one of those cold Michigan days where it just goes into your bones. You know, you've experienced that cold, where the cold just seeps into your bones, right? And it was a darkness like that that seeped into your bones. And for somehow, there was light in the land of Goshen, where the Israelites lived. But in Egypt, everything was dark. And by the way, Ra was the son of the sun god. And guess what God just did? The great I am just smacked him down. So one at a time, they had smacked down all of the gods of Egypt. But God saved one more plague. One more plague. And it would be the death of the firstborn sons of all of Egypt. From the least to the greatest, every home would experience death. God said he would make a distinction between the Egyptians and the Hebrews, and not a single Israelite would die in this last plague. And just as Moses had said, because Pharaoh would not let the children of Israel go, God sent a death angel that swept over Egypt and went into every Egyptian home and killed the firstborn in it, so that there was a cry that has never been heard before in the history of the world. Such a great cry arose from every home, because somebody in every home was dead. And then finally, Pharaoh relents and allows the Israelites to leave Egypt. Later, however, he would, whether it was revenge or just simply reneging on that agreement, but he would eventually pursue the children of Israel. But that's a whole other story I don't have time to get into today. What's the distinction? God made a distinction between the children of Israel and the people of Egypt. And what was that distinction? And if we miss this morning, this would be a tragedy. What's the distinction between Egypt and Israel? The distinction can be summed up in one word, and that is obey. That one word is obey. And here are four reasons today, this morning, and I'm going to go through them really quickly, but four reasons why obey needs to make a comeback in the U.S. of A and in our home today. To obey is to align. If you got your Bibles, open them up to Exodus chapter 12. I've been sharing with you this story of the 10 plagues, but let me read just a little bit for you this morning. And now my pad closed up. That's, I guess, why you should have a Bible with you all the time, a real one. Okay, I'm serious. I don't have my Bible here. It's because everybody else has their pads open and I can't get mine open. Thank you, dear. Isn't she awesome? Saving me. Okay, Exodus chapter 12. Yes, thank you. Exodus chapter 12, verses 21 through 24. Then Moses summoned all the elders of Israel and said to them, "Go at once and select the animals for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb." Let me stop right there and let me ask, why was there a distinction between the children of Israel and the people of Egypt? Okay, I talked about distinction. Why was there a distinction between the children of Israel and Egypt? And I said that one word, it could be summed up in one word, which was what? Thank you. Very good. So Moses had summoned all the elders of Egypt and said to them, "Go at once and select the animals for your families and slaughter the Passover lamb." The what? Passover. They didn't really know that word yet because it hadn't happened, but that death angel was going to pass over all the homes, right? "Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it into the blood in the basin, and put some of the blood on the top and on both sides of the door frame. None of you shall go out of the door of your house until morning. When the Lord goes through the land to strike down the Egyptians, he will see the blood on the top and sides of the door frame and will pass over that doorway, and he will not permit the destroyer to enter your houses and strike you down." Notice that the Israelites did as God instructed. They slaughtered the lamb and they put the blood on the door frame of their houses, on their homes. And you see, brothers and sisters, what this is, what it means is to obey is to align. Everybody say align. Now, why on the door frames? Why not? I don't know. Why not on your car or in your... Why on your door frames? It seemed like a strange place to put it. But the door frame of the home is the access to the home. Everybody in the house must go in or out through the doorway and through the blood. It's a declaration of your alignment with God's plan. It's living in obedience to God's direction. It's like Joshua saying in Joshua 24:15, where he says, "As for me and my house, we will do what? We will serve the Lord." Now, in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 3, do we have that verse today? Do we have that verse? 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 3, you can look it up later, but the Apostle Paul says that the head of Christ is God, and the head of man is Christ, and the head of wife is husband. Did you hear that? And the head of children is their parents. Ephesians 5. Let me go to this one right away. Notice I said the head of wife is husband. Did you know that it was about 1980? It was actually with Princess Di and with Prince Charles that was one of the first times where that whole love, honor, and obey was removed from wedding ceremonies. How many of you actually said that in your wedding ceremony? I bet we could separate that basically by age. Basically, I could say who among us is old? Raise your hand. Who is young? The old probably said it. The young probably omitted it. It's been omitted from most wedding ceremonies because obey smacks of, well, tyranny, of like a dictatorship. It almost sounds like communism. Communism in America. You want me to what? Well, listen to this. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Brothers and sisters, it would be easy for a wife to love and honor and obey her husband if her husband loved her as much as he loves Christ. Wouldn't it? The problem in America is that most men aren't obeying, aligning themselves with God's plan, and so therefore it's hard to follow them, isn't it? When they don't know where they're going, if I said, where are you going? And they said, well, I don't know. I don't know where I'm going. How are you going to follow them when they don't even know where they're going? Our wives are not dumb, men. Our wives are not dumb. They know exactly whether or not you know where you're headed and where you're going. And if your head is not Christ, whose head is God, if you're not aligned with that, then why should your wife follow you? Why would your wife say, yeah, I'll obey you, even though you don't know where you're going? By the way, 2 Corinthians 6:14 says, don't be yoked with unbelievers. Don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. In other words, don't marry somebody who's not a Christian, because that alignment then gets all out of whack. It really does. It really does. It gets all out of whack because we aren't aligned with God's plan. And then comes chaos and destruction and death, as we saw in Egypt. By the way, the first commandment with a promise, kids, is honor your father and your mother, that your days will be long on the land, in the land that the Lord is giving you. And Ephesians 6:1 says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Listen, if there's any problem, if we could easily identify our problems in America today, it would be a rejection or a defiance to authority. How often do we see people, rejecting authority? We see it all the time in the nightly news. If children don't learn to obey their parents, then they're not going to obey their teachers. And if they don't obey their teachers, they're not going to obey the police when they say stop or whatever. And then they're going to disrespect their bosses, and they're going to, and you see on down the line. And then when it comes to getting married, forget that obey stuff. We're not going to obey our spouses or anything like that. And you see what happens? And then we're not going to follow God either. Obedience. To obey is to align. And we need to be aligned with God's plan. And we see Israel was aligned with God's plan. They went out and they sacrificed the lamb and they put the blood on the doorpost, and no one died in their homes. Then we see to obey is to love. Let's look at Exodus chapter 13 and verses 21 through 22. Exodus 13 and 21 through 22. By day the Lord went ahead, and this is when they left Egypt, and until they entered into the promised land. By day the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of the cloud to guide them on their way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so that they could travel by day or night. Neither the pillar of the cloud by day nor the pillar of the fire by night left its place in front of the people. Brothers and sisters, to obey is to love. When Israel left Egypt, they followed the Lord in the form of the pillar of the cloud by day and the pillar of the fire by night. They all even followed Moses into the Red Sea. Remember that story with the wall of water on their left and the water on their right? To obey means to follow. That's really what it means. To obey means to follow, which means to love. Do you know how I know that Brenda loves me? She gave me her iPad. No. She has followed me all over the globe in the name of Christ. without complaint. Jesus called his disciples and he said, what did he say when he called them? He said what? Follow me, didn't he? And then he said, anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. And my Father will love them and we will come to them and make our home with them. The Apostle Paul said, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. You see that alignment in place there? What is it that we all want for our home? Don't we want a home of love and of peace? Don't we? Right? And we realize that all the money in the world, all the fame in the world, all the success in the world cannot buy joy. It cannot buy peace. It cannot buy love, can it? Sorry, Tom, it can't do it. He's our treasure. And, you know, money just can't buy love, can it? It cannot. I love that when Jesus says, if you love me, you'll obey my teachings, and my Father will come in and will make our home with you and your home with the great I am. Will be a home of love. It will be a home of peace. It will be a home of joy. And that's something money can't buy if we'll just decide to obey, if we'll follow. If we'll follow Jesus, he'll lead us straight to the Father. You see that alignment? If we follow Jesus, he'll lead us straight to the Father. The source of love, the source of peace, the source of joy. If we'll follow him, if we'll submit to him, if we'll obey his commands. To obey is also to be ready to go. This is so cool. Let's look at Exodus 12 and verse 11. Exodus 12 verse 11, and this is so neat, and I didn't understand this until just this week. This is how you are to eat it. This is the Passover meal. With your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. What a strange thing to say. Now think about it. This is the greatest of all the meals that the Hebrews would celebrate each year as an annual thing, and they're told to eat it in haste. They're told to eat it ready to go. It's strange. They ate the meal of the roasted lamb, the bitter herbs, and the unleavened bread. They ate it ready to go. They ate it in haste. Their robes, what that means, their robes were tucked into their belt so that they could do what? They could run. So they could run with their staff in their hand. Standing up, it seems. What's that mean? It means they ate this meal with an agenda. After 430 years of slavery in Egypt, they were about to be set free, and they were headed for where? They were headed for the promised land. Here it is, folks. Obedience has as much to do with where we're going as where we are right now. You see that? Obedience has to do, everything to do with where we're going. It's not just living life for today, for right now, but knowing that at any moment, God could call us heavenward in Christ Jesus. And you know what? We're at peace with all of that. Are you at peace? If the Lord was to come back right this moment, would you say, amen, come Lord Jesus? Or would you say, oh, no. Yikes. Well, how can we be at peace? How can we be ready to go? How can we be prepared? How can we live life with no regrets? Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 15 is right amidst that whole armor of God message where the Apostle Paul says, put on the full armor of God. And in one of those verses, in verse 15, he says, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. I never understood that verse until I connected it with the Passover. The gospel is like a brand new pair of Chuck Taylor Converse tennis shoes. Or today for you kids, it would be like a brand new pair of Air Jordans. In other words, the gospel is what we put on our feet that gives us flight so that we can jump higher and run faster so that we're ready for whatever comes our way. And Jesus said, look, I am coming soon. And Jesus says, be ready to go. Be ready to go. And that's what the gospel teaches us. It teaches us that at any moment, Jesus is coming back, and we as a people of God, serving the great I Am, need to be ready to go. And we're not going to rest until everybody in our family and everybody in our circle is all ready to go. And that's why our feet are fitted with that gospel, that good news that prepares us to be ready to go. And I'm already out of time. All right, I got to go on. To obey is to be righteous. Exodus 12, verses 24 through 28. Let's look at those again here. Obey these instructions, Moses says, as a lasting ordinance for you and your descendants. When you enter the land that the Lord will give you as He promised, observe this ceremony. And when your children ask you, what does this ceremony mean to you? Then tell them, it is the Passover sacrifice to the Lord who passed over the houses of the Israelites in Egypt and spared our homes when He struck down the Egyptians. Then the people bowed down and worshiped. What's all this mean, Mom? What's all this mean, Dad? The blood of the Lamb saved us from death. The blood over the doorway protected us, making us right with God. And that's what righteousness means. It means right with God. It's a symbol of our obedience. It was something that the Israelites actually had to do. You understand that? It was something that the Israelites had to do in order to protect their home. It was an act of obedience to the command of God through Moses. And they did it. Now, there are those who would say that there are many different ways to God, and there's many different ideas. You have your way, which is good for you. You have your way, that's great for you. But you know what? I'm going to make my own way. Kind of sounds a little bit like Pharaoh, doesn't it? But for Israel, it was all about obedience. And it was all about the blood of the Lamb. Do you know how Jesus was introduced to the world by John the Baptist? In the very first chapter of the Gospel of John, you can read it. You can read it right there in chapter 1 of John. He says, "Look, the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world." The Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. And then in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 18 and 19, we see, "You were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." You see, brothers and sisters, to obey is to align ourselves with God's plan. It's to love and to follow. It's to be ready to go. Because Jesus said, "Behold, I'm coming soon." And it's to be righteous in a right relationship with God through the blood. Through the blood of the Lamb. Ruth Graham is the late wife of the evangelist Billy Graham. She went to be with the Lord in 2007. Her tombstone is very simple. And chiseled into the top of that tombstone is a Chinese character. She was born in China. And so that Chinese character is the character E. Everybody say E. And that character means righteous. Now, I've talked to literally hundreds, if not thousands, of Chinese people as we ministered over 17 years in Taiwan, and I said, explain to me where that character came from. It's a very ancient character in the Chinese language. Explain to me how you came about this character of righteous. For you see, brothers and sisters, that character for righteous is actually two characters in the Chinese language. The top portion of that character is yang, which is lamb. The bottom character, wo, is me. The lamb over me is righteous. My question for you this morning is, will you trust the Lamb? Will you accept Him and will you obey Him? Trust and obey? Or will you, like Pharaoh, say, I am. Life is all about me. Will you harden your heart? Brothers and sisters, I believe life is all about obedience. And in obedience, we find freedom. And that freedom is found in Jesus Christ. If you have a decision to make this morning, if you've been having authority issues, won't you come as we stand and as we sing?